equipped for the rising. That give us this force. And fill us with knowledge.
I thank my Heavenly Father for giving this wonderful opportunity to share His words with you. And I also thank my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for choosing me as His servant to share His wonderful words of life with dear friends like you. Not only that one, I bring you loving greetings from all the dear brothers and sisters from Bangalore, especially from my hometown Ecclesia, and my mother and my Mrs. Usha Kumari. And also from your teacher, Brother Kutino Miranda. Dear brothers and sisters, you all know that after God called the people of Israel out of Egypt, He took them to the land of Canaan. And after taking them to the land of Canaan, God distributed the land equally to all the tribes of Israel. But except to the tribe of Levi, God did not give any inheritance in the land. So where did the people of Levites live? Where were they living? Jacob had how many sons? 12 sons, isn't it? So one of the sons was Levi. God gave the land to all the 11 tribes. But the tribe of Levi, God never gave any inheritance. That means where were they residing? If you see, they were residing all around the tabernacle. We know something about the tabernacle arrangement which God gave to the people of Israel through Moses. And all around the tabernacle, these Levites were residing. Okay. Now actually if you see, among the Levites, there were actually four divisions. Actually, Levi had three sons. Now, one son was Gershon, other son was Merari, other was Kohath. About that one, we can read in Exodus 6th chapter, 16th verse. Exodus 6th chapter 16th verse.
These were the names of the sons of Levi, according to their record. Gershon, Kohath and Merari.
See, Gershon, Kohath and Merari. So these were the three sons of Levi. And moreover, Kohath had a son whose name was Amram, and he was the father of Moses and Aaron. And that's given in verse 20.
Amram married his father's sister,
Jochebed,
to whom Aaron and Moses. Amram
just one. See, to whom were born the sons of Moses and Aaron. Therefore, you can see, Levi, among Levis, we can tell that there were four divisions. One is Gershon, one is Merari, another is Kohath, another is Amram. Therefore, you can tell that there are four divisions of the Levites. And these four divisions of the Levites were residing all around the tabernacle. Actually, if you see in the tabernacle arrangement, there were four directions to the tabernacle. And each of this group were residing on each of the other side of the tabernacle. Now you can tell me which group of people were residing on which side. That is given in Numbers 3rd chapter verse 23 tells about where the Gershonites were residing. Numbers 3rd chapter 23rd verse.
The Gershonite land was camped on the west.
See, the Gershonites were supposed to camp on the west side of the tabernacle. Now what about Kohath? Kohath was on which side? That is given in verse 29.
The Kohathites
were supposed to camp on the south side of the tabernacle. Now what about Merari, the third division? They were supposed to reside on the north direction of the tabernacle. That is given in verse 35. They were to camp on the north side of the tabernacle. Now what about Amram? That is, what about Moses and Aaron? They were supposed to camp on the east side of the tabernacle, and that is given in verse 38. See, they were supposed to camp on the east of the tabernacle. And we all know very well that God used to tell the people of Israel to shift this tabernacle from one place to other place. And during that time, these Levites were supposed to carry all the items in the tabernacle and shift along with that one. And you see, in the while shifting this items of the tabernacle, not everybody can carry each and every item. Each and every group given particular items as in charge to them. And that is given in same chapter, see, same chapter, verse 25 and 26 tells about what was the in charge of Gershonites. See, verse 25 and 26. Verse 25 and 26. Same chapter.
At the tent of meeting, the Gershonites are responsible for the care of the tabernacle and its covering. The curtain at the entrance to the tent of meeting. The curtain to the courtyard.
See, the curtains of the courtyard. We all know about the courtyard. See, this is the curtains of the courtyard. These curtains of the courtyard was given to the Gershonites as in charge. Next. Continue.
The curtain, the entrance of the courtyard, surrounding the tabernacle, the altar, and the rope and everything related to the
tent. See, the entrance also tells. The entrance means the door to the tabernacle. Now you tell me, how many entrance was there to the tabernacle? How many gate was there? Only one gate was there. So that gate also was given as a in charge to the Gershonites. Now what about Kohathites? What was the item given to Kohathites as in charge? That is given in verse number 31. Verse 31. Same chapter, verse 31.
They were responsible for the care of the ark, the table, the lampstand.
See, they were responsible for the ark. Then table. See, the table of the shewbread. Then the lampstand, the golden candlesticks. Then
the altars.
See, altars. Altars means two. Isn't it? If you see in the tabernacle, there were two altars. One was in the court, that is the brazen altar, and one was in the holy place, that is the incense altar. All these two altars were given as in charge to the Kohathites. Next, continue.
The articles of the sanctuary,
everything related to their use. See, everything related to their use was given to the Kohathites as a in charge. Now what about Merari? That is given in verse number 37. Verse 37.
They were appointed to take care of the frames of the tabernacle.
Then, the
cross bar,
all
the places,
and
everything related to the Jew, as well as the posts of the founding courtyard, their faces,
See, the pillars of the court. This means, see, you can in this Lenin court, see, you can see the wooden pillars. It's made out of acacia wood. These pillars were given as a in charge to the Merari. So, Merari were given in charge of the these wooden pillars. Now, what about Moses and Aaron? What was the in charge given to them? That is given in verse 38. Same chapter, verse 38.
Moses and Aaron and his sons were responsible for the care of the sanctuary.
See, they were responsible for the care of the sanctuary. The complete overall in charge of the sanctuary was given to Moses and Aaron. So, Amram, that means they were given the complete in charge of the tabernacle. So, what is the meaning of this one? And not only that one, whenever they used to carry the items of the tabernacle from one place to other place, for their convenience, God had given them the bullock cart also. And that is given to us in Numbers 6th chapter. Sorry, Numbers 7th chapter. Sorry, Numbers 7th chapter, verse 6 to 9. Numbers 7th chapter, verses 6 to 9.
And Moses took the wagon and the oxen and gave them unto the Levites.
See, Moses took the oxen and the wagons and gave them to the Levites. Then,
two wagons and four oxen. Given to the sons of Gershon.
See, Gershonites were given how many oxen, sir? Four oxen and how many wagons?
Two
wagons were given to the Gershonites. Then,
according to their service, four wagons and eight oxen gave unto the sons of Merari.
See, how many oxen? Eight oxen and four wagons were given to the sons of Merari. Then,
according to unto their service, under the hand of
Then what about Kohathites? Continue.
The
the son of Aaron, the priest. But unto the sons of Kohath, he gave none.
See, but unto the sons of Kohath, they gave none nations, sir. They were not given any bullocks, sir. They were not given any wagons, sir. And how did they carry the items of the tabernacle? Continue. How did they carry?
The service of the sanctuary belonged unto them.
See, they were supposed to bear everything upon their shoulders. That means whenever the tabernacle was shifted, all the items in the holy and the most holy, the most sacred items, they were supposed to carry it upon their shoulders. Now what about Moses and Aaron? They were not given anything because the complete in charge was given to them instead of giving any particular items. So what is the meaning of this one? What is the meaning of the four group of people who are residing on the four sides of the tabernacle? What does this one represent? And moreover, what are the items that were given as a in charge to them? So what does all these things represent? You all know about tabernacle. I think Krishna has taken the subject of tabernacle to you. Now you tell me, in the olden days, tabernacle was there. In the tabernacle, in the most holy position, there was an Ark of the Covenant. And always, there is to be the presence of God. So we know that one, a tabernacle represents the presence of God. Therefore, tabernacle means what? Tabernacle means, tabernacle shows the presence of God. And the four group of people who are residing all around the tabernacle shows that these four group of people are very close to God. Isn't it? Now you tell me, who are the four group of people who will be very close to God by the end of 7000 years? You tell me. You know about the plan of salvation which God has made for the whole world, isn't it? Those who don't know the answer, only they should answer. You tell me, we know about the plan of salvation, no? God has made a plan of salvation for 7000 years. In the 7000 years, God is selecting how many class of people from this earth? How many class of people? Four class of people. Very good, sir. Tell me, which are the four class of people? Very good. Very good. Very good. So these are the four class of people. Very good. 100 out of 100. Okay, these are the four group of people whom God is selecting in this 7000 years. Therefore, these four groups of people residing on the four directions of the tabernacle represents four types of salvations. Actually, there are two types of salvations. One is the heavenly salvation, another is the earthly salvation. Isn't it? God is the savior of all men, but especially of those who believe. 1 Timothy 4th chapter 10th verse. 1 Timothy 4th chapter 10th verse. See, who is the savior of all men? Especially of those who believe. That means there is a special salvation to those who believe in this gospel age. Of course, God is going to save all the mankind. But especially those who believe in the gospel age, God has kept a heavenly salvation. There are two types of salvations. Even Christ told, no, among all that are born out of women, who is the greatest? Moses or John the Baptist? Isn't John the Baptist is greatest? But he that attains to that heavenly salvation, the least member coming to the heavenly salvation, he is greater than John the Baptist. So there we can see the two salvations. One is heavenly salvation, another is the earthly salvation. Even God told to Abraham, I'll make the seed as the stars of the heaven and as the sand of the seashore. So two salvations are there. In the two salvation, there are two divisions. In heavenly salvation, there is two divisions, isn't it? Lack and 44,000. Other is great company. In the earthly salvation, there are two divisions. One is ancient worthies, other is the general world, isn't it? Therefore, we can see the four group represents the four types of salvation. Now, you tell me, Gershonites, what is the meaning of Gershon? I'll tell you, Gershon means rescued, okay? And they were residing on the west direction of the tabernacle. Now, you tell me, what is the meaning of west in the Bible and what is the meaning of rescued? This class of people represents the class of people whom God is going to rescue during the 1000-year reign of Christ. This represents the general world who shall be rescued in the 1000-year reign of Christ. They were residing on the west direction. What is the meaning of west in the Bible? Now you tell me, what is the meaning of west in the Bible? What is the meaning of west? Actually, west means it is a earthly course. See, sun rises which direction? East. If sun has to rise in the east, then earth has to rotate towards the west. If the earth rotates towards the west, then only the sun will seem to be rising in the east. So west in the Bible means earthly course. Therefore, this represents the class of people who are going to be resurrected in the 1,000 years and come to the earthly salvation, the general world. You can see they were given the in charge of the outer linen coat. So what is the meaning of the outer linen coat? You tell me, what is the meaning of this outer linen coat? See? Somebody told her. My wife told her. Tell me, what is the meaning of this coat?
Wife should not open
in Bombay, only in Bangalore. No permit in Bombay. Now what is the meaning of this, sir? White linen. See, white linen means justification, isn't it? Revelation 19 chapter 8 verse. Revelation 19 chapter 8 verse. See, fine linen stands for the righteousness of the saints. Therefore, this coat represents the righteousness. In the 1,000 years, if any man has to be justified before the sight of God, they have to come through only one gate. Isn't it? If any man has to enter the tabernacle, they have to come through this only one gate. So similarly, in the 1,000 years, if anybody has to attain the salvation, okay, they have to come only through this one gate. And who is that gate? Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ told, I am the way, the truth and the life. He told, no, I am the true gate. See, John 10 chapter 9th verse. John 10th chapter 9th verse. John 10th chapter 9th verse. See, I am the door. Christ told us, he is the door. So if anybody has to attain the salvation, it is only through Christ. We read in Acts 4 chapter 12 verse now, there is no other name given under heaven whereby man has to be saved than the name of Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ is the only gate, and if anybody has to be justified in 1,000 years, it is only through the gate called Jesus Christ. Therefore, when Christ is going to come during his second coming, he is going to rule on this earth for a period of 1,000 years. In that 1,000 years, he is going to resurrect all the dead mankind back to life on the same earth. We read in the Bible now, as in Adam all die, so in Christ all shall be made alive. Now how do the people die in Adam? Do they all die in the same day? No, they don't die the same day. Similarly, during the 1,000 years, when all the mankind will be resurrected, when all the mankind will be brought back to life on the same earth, they won't be brought back at a single day. They will be brought in batches. As they died in batches, similarly in Christ they shall be made alive in batches. And not only that one, the resurrection also shall be in the reverse order. Like for example, who was the first person to die? Abel, then Cain, and likewise it came on. But in the resurrection process, who will come back first in the resurrection? Not Cain will come back, not Abel will come back, isn't it? It will be in the reverse order. The person who is going to die last, he is the first person to be resurrected in the 1,000 years. And not only the resurrection, even the age also will go in a reverse order. Now, age, what happens? As we grow older, from 30, 40, 50, 60, nobody is a century now. Isn't it? 60 only out, isn't it? So, before 60, 45. Your score is 45. My score is less than that one only. I hope so. Okay, anyway, but in the 1,000 years, what will happen? This age will also go in a back order, isn't it? From 60 to 50, 50 to 40, 40 to 30, 30 to 20. Then what will happen? They'll become a small baby. Why 30? Perfect man age, isn't it? Because Christ, that was a perfect man's age. Even Adam was created at the age of 30 years. Even Christ took a baptism at the age of 30 years. And anybody was supposed to serve in the tabernacle, he was supposed to be the age of 30 to 50 years. 30 years is a perfect man's age. So in the 1,000 years, everybody are going to come back to that age. So in 1,000 years, there is no need for anybody to put dye also, isn't it? Already my hairs are started to grow white, isn't it? But in 1,000 years, no dye and all these things and all, because automatically God will give a hair subset automatically start to grow in a black condition. Anyway, this is about the 1,000 years. So what will happen? All the persons will be brought back to life, and in the age also will go in a backward order. Job 33:25. Job Old Testament or New Testament?
His flesh shall be fresher than a child.
See, his flesh shall be fresher than a child. Just imagine, in 1,000 years, then continue. Finish that verse.
He returns to the days of his youth.
So that will be in the condition in the 1,000 years. In the 1,000 years, as the people show obedience, they shall return to the days of their youth. And how will their flesh be? Their flesh shall be fresher than a child itself. Just imagine a small baby, just a newborn baby, how the flesh will be, how the skin will be. So tender, no? Isn't it so nice, no? So soft. So similarly, in 1,000 years, everybody shall be so good looking and so soft. So in 1,000 years, just imagine which is the soap that people will use. And nowadays they use Lux, Pierre, Lifebuoy, Fair and Lovely soap. Some people use even Rin also. But in 1,000 years, with soap. Some people in 1,000 years, which soap they will use? For the baby, which soap you will put? Johnson and Johnson baby soap. That's the soap everybody will use in the 1,000 years. That's the condition. Just imagine what type of restitution God is going to bring in this world. Just imagine, who can ever imagine the such a plan of God? Not only the restitution of human beings, it is also going to be the restitution of animals also. We read in the Bible now, the wolf shall dwell with the lamb, isn't it? And lion shall eat the straw. So in the 1,000 years, there won't be any non-vegetarian also. So whatever non-vegetarian item you want to eat it now itself. In the 1,000 years, you won't get any opportunity also, isn't it? And not only that one, in the 1,000 years, there won't be any zoo also, isn't it? If you want to see any lion, tiger and all, it will be roaming before your house only. You can just call and he'll come and play with your kids also. So that will be the wonderful condition in the 1,000 years. We read in the Bible that God shall wipe away all their tears, isn't it? And all the sorrow, pain and sickness shall be gone forever. And the former things have passed away. There shall be no more death. This is the plan of salvation which God has made for the whole world. Therefore, this is the Gershonites. This is the first group. And the second group is Kohat. And Kohat were residing on the south direction of the tabernacle. Now, what does Kohat mean in the Bible? And what is the meaning of south in the Bible? Kohat means comrade. Comrade or companion. Okay? So, Kohat means companion. And what is the meaning of south in the Bible? What is the meaning of south? Tell me. Earthly, this one. Correct. How can I tell that it's earth? North means? Because who is there in the north? Our Heavenly Father's house is in the north direction. Moreover, Satan also desired to ascend to the sides of the north, because that was the kingdom, that was the place where Almighty God is living, isn't it? The opposite of north is south. So opposite of heaven is earth. So this represents the second group of people who are going to come to the earthly salvation. That is the Kohat. And you tell me, who is the second group of people who are going to come to the earthly salvation apart from the general world? Ancient warriors. So faith warriors are going to come in the 1,000 years. Okay? And they are going to be the representatives of God during the 1,000 years. Therefore, you can see, they were given the inches of the Ark of the Covenant, isn't it? And they were supposed to carry everything upon their shoulders. Now, what is the meaning of shoulders in the Bible? See, for each and every word has a meaning in the Bible. For the Bible, Bible is its own dictionary. If you want to see anything, we need to search from the Bible itself. Now, you tell me, what is the meaning of shoulder in the Bible? Where does the shoulder come in the Bible? Tell me a few verses. Unto us a child is born. Read Isaiah 9 chapter 6 verse. Isaiah 9th chapter 6th verse. Correct. See, the government shall be upon his shoulders. Means shoulders means what? The responsibility of the government. That means they were supposed to carry it upon the shoulders. Means all the responsibility of the government shall be upon the shoulders of the ancient worthies. The visible government responsibility shall be upon the shoulders of the ancient worthies. Therefore, they will be the representatives of God. Therefore, even the Ark of the Covenant is in charge. Ark of the Covenant is to represent the presence of God. So they are going to be the representatives of God in the 1,000 years. Therefore, in the resurrection, when they are going to come back, they are going to come back in what type of resurrection? Better resurrection. Isn't it? Hebrews 11 chapter 35 verse. No need to read. What is the meaning of better resurrection? Something better than the general resurrection is called a better resurrection. So what is the difference? General resurrection, they will come in the same imperfect body. And as they show obedience, they will get a perfect body. But what is the difference about the ancient worthies? They died with an imperfect body. But when they are going to come back in the resurrection, do you think they are going to come in the same imperfect body? No, they are going to come in the perfect body. Just imagine what is the meaning of perfect body. There were two human beings perfect in this earth. Who are they? Adam and Eve. Jesus Christ, isn't it? The first Adam and second Adam, isn't it? Just imagine, because of first Adam, we are all suffering. But because of second Adam, we are all rejoicing today. Just imagine the condition of this world. Just 2000 years before our Lord came to this earth. In these 2000 years, 35% of the world is converted to Christianity. And there are so many hospitals, so many homes for the aged, so many orphanages. All because of just one name called as Jesus Christ. He was a perfect man. Just imagine, because of one perfect man, there is a lot of development in this world. Just imagine if there are 1,000 Jesus Christ in the 1,000 years, how it will be. Just imagine if there is 100, how it will be. That is what is going to happen in the 1,000 years. All the ancient worthies are going to be resurrected as Christ was in this earth. And they will teach the other people and they will be like Christ. Just imagine the condition of this world in the 1,000 years. So through them, the truth will pass on to all the people of this world. And moreover, they were also given the in charge of the the second veil. So what is the meaning of the second veil? Isn't it? The second veil, actually the second veil was made up of three types of thread. Blue, red or scarlet, and purple. Okay? Now, what is the meaning of blue in the Bible? Blue means faithfulness. See, the blue sky, that represents the faithfulness of God. We read in the Bible, no? Jesus Christ tells, so God is faithful. He gives the rain to the, and the rain and the sunlight both to the rich and the poor, isn't it? For the good and the evil. If a blue in the Bible represents faithfulness, what is the meaning of red? Red means death. Isaiah 1st chapter 18th verse, we can read that one. Isaiah 1st chapter 18th verse. Isaiah 1st chapter 18th verse.
Come now, let us be together.
Hmm. See, they shall be as white as snow, then.
Though they are red as crimson,
they
shall be like
gold. See, it represents sin and death. Okay? And what does purple mean in the Bible? Purple means royalty. So we can see in the subject of rich man Lazarus. What was the cloth that was the rich man was wearing? He was wearing a purple robe. So in mixing colors and all, I think Uncle Barthe would be knowing. If you mix red and blue, which color you will get, Uncle? Purple. So red means death. Blue means faithfulness. So faithfulness and death will give you purple, means royalty. So these persons will get the royalty in the 1,000 years because they were faithful to God till their death. So they will be the visible representatives of God in the 1,000 years. They shall be visible rulers. Isn't it? Psalms 45:16. Psalms 45th chapter 16th verse. Psalms 45th chapter 16th verse. Psalms 45th chapter 16th verse. Psalms 45:16. You can read it. See, instead of your fathers, they shall be your sons, whom thou shall make princes in all the earth. So these shall be made princes in all the earth. That means, what is the meaning of this one? That That means in each and every nation, the ancient worthies shall be the prime ministers. So they shall be the visible prime ministers. So mostly, who will be the prime minister of Egypt? I think it will be Moses, because Moses was supposed to be the former prime minister of Egypt. He was supposed to be the prince of Egypt, but unfortunately he ran away from Egypt. So mostly he'll get a opportunity in 1,000 years to be the prince of Egypt, to be the prime minister of Egypt in 1,000 years. And what about Daniel? Which country will Daniel rule?
Babylon.
So Babylon means today's Saddam Hussein's place, isn't it? So he will be along with Saddam Hussein in the 1,000 years. Then what about Pakistan? Who will go to Pakistan? Samson will go to Pakistan, because Hindi mein bolte hai na, laton ke bhoot baaton se nahi mante karke. Isliye hai, to kya bolte hai, udhar ko kisko bhej denge? Pakistan ko Samson ko bhej denge. So what will happen in the 1,000 years? Samson will mostly, I think, this is my thought anyway, so mostly Samson will go to Pakistan. So what about India? Who will come to India? Gideon. You know who will come to India? 420. Who is 420? Deceiver. Who is deceiver? Jacob. So he is the 420. So he is deceiver, no? His name Jacob means deceiver, isn't it? So whole Asia is blocked him. So I think mostly he will take care of that one. Anyway, but who will be the world's president in 1,000 years? John the Baptist. Just imagine, he did not have proper clothes to wear also. But God is going to lift him to such a high position that he is going to be the world's president during the 1,000 years. So all the visible kingdom shall be upon their shoulders. And not only that one, they were also given in charge of the brazen altar. So what is the meaning of this brazen altar? Brazen altar. Okay, in the olden days, they used to sacrifice the brazen, they used to sacrifice on the brazen altar. You can see the brazen altar, they should sacrifice on this brazen altar. And after sacrificing, the high priest used to carry the blood to the most holy position. Anyway, what is the meaning of this brazen altar? See, as soon as you enter this gate, in front of you only, the brazen altar will come immediately. So what is the meaning of this brazen altar? Christ? Whatever sacrifice? Ransom sacrifice. See, this court, this gate is also Christ. But this is just Jesus Christ as a savior. But as soon as you accept Jesus Christ as a savior, immediately you will come to know that Christ is not only the savior of me, but he is the savior of the whole world. He is the ransom sacrifice. So in this brazen altar, there were actually four horns. See, you can see the four horns. In the olden days, the high priest, after sacrificing, he used to take little bit of blood and he used to pour it on the four horns of the altar. Okay, that represents the power of the ransom sacrifice. Horns means power. Daniel 7 chapter we read now that beast was having 10 horns. So what is the meaning of horns? Horns means 10 horns means 10 powers. So power of the ransom sacrifice. In olden days, there used to be a refuge city. I think you must be knowing something about refuge city. Do you know about refuge city? Refuge city.
To hide.
You know? You don't know. Any idea? Okay, I'll tell you a little bit about that one. Refuge city means like today's police station. Okay? Imagine if you commit murder, immediately if you go and run away and surrender yourself to police, will anybody hurt you? Similarly, it was there in the Israel also. When somebody used to do any mistake, okay, and if he enters this city, nobody was supposed to harm this person. So that was the refuge city. But this refuge city was always not there in all the places. For that purpose, God had given this brazen altar as a refuge city. If anybody went and took hold of the horns of the altar, nobody was supposed to harm that person. So that was supposed to act like a refuge city. Similarly, once what happened, Adonijah went and escaped from the sword of the Solomon and went and took hold of the horns of the altar. Why? Because to escape from the sword of the Solomon, you can read that one in 1 Kings, 1st chapter 50th verse. 1 Kings, 1st chapter 50th verse. 1 Kings, 1st chapter, 50th verse.
And
Adonijah
feared because Solomon, and he arose and went and caught hold on the horns of the altar.
See, because of the fear of Solomon, he went and caught on the horns of the altar. Okay, so that represents the it was acting like a refuge city. So similarly, in the 1000 years, if anybody has to escape from the second death, they have to catch hold strongly of the horns of the altar, even of the power of the ransom sacrifice of Christ. If they leave that one, immediately what will happen? The enemy, second death, will come and attack them and they shall go to second death. And this knowledge of the power of the ransom sacrifice, who shall give to the people? It will be given through the ancient worthies. So therefore, you can see the candlesticks. The candlesticks represents the word of God, Holy Spirit. This Holy Spirit, okay, shall be given to the people through the ancient worthies. So this is the second class of people. Now, the third group was Merari. They were residing on the north direction. Merari means what? Merari means bitterness, okay? And north means what in the Bible? North means heaven, isn't it? Now, who are the class of people who are going to go to heaven with bitter experiences? You tell me. Huh? Great company, isn't it? Everybody has to go through tribulation only. How to enter the kingdom of God? You should enter the kingdom of God through much tribulation. Today also we came through plane. It was through much tribulation, isn't it? So similarly, that plane ticket also will cost you much tribulation. But there is a lot of difference between tribulation, what the great multitude suffer, and the tribulation with the lack and 44,000 suffer. When these people are put into tribulation, they shall not voluntarily surrender to all the trials of God. Okay? And therefore, what will God do? God shall force them and God shall take away their sacrifices with the force. But their sacrifice is not a forced one, isn't it? Their sacrifice is given by them, but their sacrifice is taken by God, isn't it? So that is a lot of difference. So this makes a lot of difference even in our consecrated walk of life. So God has given us this wonderful opportunity. Just think, so many people are living in this world, but God has not given this truth to anybody. But He has chosen us among this world means how grateful we should be to God. Isn't it? How faithful we should be in our consecrated vow. We all have taken the consecrated vow that we will die for our aims and ambitions. Are we doing that one faithfully in our life? That's the question we have to put within ourselves and answer that question. See, they were supposed to go to the heaven with much tribulation, with bitter experiences. You can see that one in 1 Corinthians, 3rd chapter. The Apostle Paul tells something about that one. In 1 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, 3rd chapter, 1 Corinthians, 3rd chapter, 11th verse. You can read from verse 11.
For other foundation can no man lay
than
which is
Jesus Christ. See, which is Jesus Christ. Then continue.
But if any man buildeth on the foundation, gold, silver, costly stone, wood, hay, stubble,
Each man's work shall be made manifest. Then,
for the day shall declare it, because it is revealed in fire.
See, it shall be revealed by fire itself. Then,
and the fire itself shall prove each man's work.
See, the fire itself shall prove each man's work. Then,
what shall it be? If any man's work shall abide, which he built thereon, he shall receive. The reward.
See, he shall receive a reward. Then,
if any man's work shall be bought, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved. Yet so as through fire.
See, if his works doesn't suffer a loss, he shall receive the reward of the divine nature. But if that man's works is burnt, he shall suffer a loss and he shall lose the reward. Okay? What type of work? Apostle Paul is speaking about gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay and stubble. Just imagine, if you put all the 6 items into the fire, which are the items that will burn in fire? Do you think the gold will burn in fire, the silver will burn in fire and the precious stone will burn in fire? What will happen? The wood, hay and stubble, immediately it will be consumed by fire. Similarly, if you build such type of character, such like wood, hay and stubble, if we are put into fiery troubles, if we are losing our character, that means that we are building our character just like wood and stubble. But our character should be like what type? Gold, precious stones and silver. Just imagine if gold is put into fire, it will start glittering more, isn't it? It will start to sparkle more. Similarly, when you are put into troubles, we should manifest the character likeness of Christ. Just because they don't manifest, they lose the reward and they shall be saved yet as so by fire. So how shall they be in the 1,000 years? They shall be like angels in heaven. Okay, isn't it? So they will have the possibility to go to death always, isn't it? The second death has still power over them. Okay, and therefore you can see that one in the pillars which were given to them. These pillars were made out of acacia wood. Okay, what is the meaning of this acacia wood? Why did God choose that particularly acacia wood? God could have easily chosen sandalwood, na? Why did not God do lightweight, or else I think Veerappan would have told. Anyway, what is the meaning of acacia wood? Acacia wood means it is having three types of character. First of all, thing is it is having an aromatic character, and nothing can destroy this wood like itself, like termites, like water or sunlight. Nothing can destroy this wood by itself. Only if this wood is put into fire, then only this wood will be totally destroyed. That means these great multitude cannot die like itself. If they sin, they can die. Only if they sin, then only they shall be put into second death, or else they can remain like angels forever. Okay, this is the third class of people. The last class is Amram. Isn't it? They were residing on the east side of the tabernacle. Amram means what? Amram means exalted. So this class of people represents the class of people who are going to be exalted very high, even to the nature which God himself is having, even to the nature of divine nature. This is the last class of people, Amram. So Moses and Aaron, they were given the complete in charge, means Moses means Christ and the church, Aaron. Okay, they should be given the complete in charge of all these things in the 1,000 years, even the visible and the invisible things, isn't it? Christ told, no, all authority in heaven and earth is given to me. So all the authority which is given to Christ, he shall share it with the church during the 1,000 years. So they were residing on the east direction. What does the east mean in the Bible? Just now we saw west means earthly course. Okay, east means opposite to the earthly course. Okay, isn't it? So in the olden days, see, the high priest used to enter into this direction from the east and sacrifice. And after sacrificing, he used to take the blood and go to the holy place, offer it upon the Ark of the Covenant, and again return back from the west direction and east of just the people of Israel. That is during the Atonement Day. So east means the sacrificial course. Not only that one, east also means obedience in the Bible. See, God had planted the Garden of Eden. It was in which direction? East direction. And moreover, God called Abraham to come out of his father's land, to the promised land. Which direction did he travel? East also. And moreover, the wise men who came to see the just born child, our Lord, they came from the east direction. So east in the Bible represents obedience. If we want to be of the 144,000, we need to have two types of quality. Which one? Obedience and also sacrifice. Just obedience is also not sufficient. Okay, I think obedience adds sacrifice also, isn't it? But now only sacrifice is also not sufficient. God, Samuel tells to Saul, no? What does God tell to Samuel? What does Samuel tell to Saul? Obedience is better than sacrifice. For us, not only one is sufficient, we need two. Obedience along with sacrifice is required to attain this 144,000, isn't it? So if you want to be of the 144,000, we need to have such type of qualities. Christ told, no, in my father's house there are many mansions. If it was not so, I would never have told you. Isn't it? If I go, I'll prepare a place for you and come again and take you. Isn't it? So read it from John 14. John 14, 2. John 14, chapter 2nd verse. See, in my father's house there are many mansions. What is the meaning of mansions? Does it mean that Christ is going to build so many palaces for us and come again and take us and marry us to so many women and done? That's what the Muslim thinks. Muslim people think that Christ, after the second coming, he is going to come and take all the Muslims to heaven, it seems. And there, each person will get 40 wives, it seems. Can't control one wife only. How can you handle 40 wives in heaven? 24 wives. Anyway, okay. But what is the meaning of mansions in the Bible? Mansion means a place of dwelling. Just imagine, which was the first dwelling place which God had created for Adam? Eden, that means earth. Earth was the first dwelling place for Adam and Eve, first parents. That was the first dwelling place. Similarly, that was the first mansion. Christ is telling so many mansions means he is speaking of so many other planets. So at the end of the 1,000 years, mostly God may create different creations on the different planets and may give the complete in charge to each and every person of the 144,000 to handle each and every planet. So I think Brother Russell suggested one in one of his volumes. Anyway, mostly we can also say that God would definitely do so in his plan. Anyway, to attain that class of people, we need to be like Christ, isn't it? We need to be in the image of Christ. That's the only one condition which God is seeking from the church, that you be in the image of his son. If you are in the image of his son, definitely you are going to receive that reward. And that is shown to us in the Bible in Revelation 4th chapter. See, Revelation 4th chapter 6th verse. Revelation 4th chapter 6th verse. Revelation 4 chapter 6 verse. See, and before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal items. Before the throne there was a sea of glass items. It was like a crystal items. So what is the meaning of the sun? So what is the sea of glass that was before the throne? So who is upon the throne? Heavenly Father is upon the throne. So, there is something before the throne that is like a sea of glass it seems. So, what does the glass do? Mirror. What does the mirror do? Reflect. What does it reflect? If you go and stand before the mirror, will that mirror reflect by the frame? It will reflect your image. Similarly, if the mirror is before the throne, it should reflect what? The person who is on the throne, his image should be reflected in the mirror. Now you tell me, who is the person who is reflect the Heavenly Father's character correctly? Jesus Christ. So this is showing about the Christ likeness, isn't it? Jesus Christ reflects the character of God perfectly. Therefore he told to John, to Philip, if you have seen me, like seeing the Father, isn't it? Now read one more verse in Revelation 21. Even the church is also compared to the sea of glass. Revelation 21st chapter 18th verse. Revelation 21:18. See, like clear glass it seems. This city is Mount Zion, the 144,000. If we want to attain to that class, we should also be in the image of Christ. We should also be the xerox copies of Christ. May we all pray that God may give us the grace and the sufficient of Holy Spirit to attain the likeness of His Son. I thank my Heavenly Father and my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for leading me and guiding me and for giving me this wonderful opportunity. And not only that one, the family members and the Bhase for giving me the opportunity to share His wonderful word of life. Thank you.
Thank you, brother. Nice to hear. And we have been hearing subject, but sometimes it gets,